across the world, birds are amazing. Without a doubt, there's more diversity in any tropical country, of course. And the more, you know, tropical you get, like rainforest type environments, that diversity just continues to skyrocket for a variety of reasons. They fill so many different niches. They're so highly evolved to fit those niches, and it impacts everything about their structure, their life history, their wing shape, their bill shape, their leg length, their color is intricately related to reproduction, and it's just incredible. So there's just so many things about birds really that make them amazing, from the obvious to the more intricate. My name is Chris Ketola. I'm the head field research coordinator for Fauna Forever, and I also directly oversee our ornithological research program. In terms of the research sites that we've spent most of our time in, since I've been with Fauna Forever and Wilderness International, it's around 400 species now. So I suspect there's a few species still out there for us to find, but still, 400 is a pretty impressive number for, you know, an area that as big as it is, it's still, in the context of the whole world, it's a relatively small place. The goal of our research would be, again, like the other teams, kind of a mixture. Some of them are projects that have a very specific question and answer, hopefully. And then a lot of the work we do on a daily basis is this sort of long-term monitoring. And what we're looking for in that case is, once again, changes within a site year to year, changes within a site by the season, changes between two sites. And these sites could be quite close to each other, or they could be very far away. And these changes can be caused from natural causes, but they can often be caused from climate change or other human activities as well. We have netting stations we've been using now for, in some cases, 7, 8, 9 years. And that allows us to track how it changes in that area. But when it comes to where we choose to put our mist nets, at the beginning, they are placed 200 meters randomly along the trail system. Once we've chosen that location, it does not change. The nets are put up using 3-meter-long aluminum poles, and we always do this the day before we start raining, so it's kind of an afternoon or late morning job we have to do in advance of the next day, because no one wants to put up mist nets at 3:30 a.m. The standard day, especially for most volunteers that join us, would involve waking up pretty early. You definitely don't want to see the sun when you're waking up, because it's already too late. And then, yeah, hitting the trails usually 15 minutes to an hour before sunrise. So these mist nets are very thin netting. It's very hard for the birds to see. And then when these birds fly in, we capture them. We take them out very carefully. And then we take them back to a central station, a central table. And then we begin to process them. The first step is to put a ring or a band on its leg. And these rings or bands are basically like license plates for birds. They're a unique number, and that bird has that number, and it's the only one in the world that has that exact number with the combination of address and details on it. And that allows us, or theoretically anyone else who catches this bird, to be able to identify it and identify where it was first caught, how old it is, etc. After that, we take a variety of morphological measurements, wing length, leg length, bill shape, etc., the weight, of course. We also then look at characteristics that refer to breeding. So for example, the females and sometimes males will lose feathers on their breast when they're keeping eggs warm. It's called a brood patch. We also look at the health of the bird in terms of fat storage. And then finally, arguably the hardest part, who needs the most experience, is determining the age of the bird. We can tell, in most cases, if the bird is over a year or under a year. And it's very difficult. You have to look at feather structure, feather color, how extensive the molt has been in their first year, and even looking at the ossification in their skull. An open skull, as we call it, indicates a young bird, and a closed skull indicates an older bird. This is something that occurs in bird ringing across the world, but it has its own set of challenges here in the Amazon and the Neotropics, for sure. We really do need to be careful working with them. You know, they are extremely delicate animals. I mean, of the groups that I work with, by far, they are the most delicate. We need to be careful ourselves as experienced people, but then we have to be very careful as well that we teach these skills in a very ethical and conscientious manner to volunteers coming in. Starting to understand how to safely hold a bird, and then how the next step after you know how to hold it is actually how to take it out of the net. You need to learn how to hold it before you take it out of the net. And then physically, you know, how to take those measurements consistently. Although bird banding is what most people will probably be aware of and do most of their day or most of their morning, there are other methodologies we utilize to monitor populations as well. Those involve point counts, which are a very experienced surveyor, which is at the moment normally me, standing in one location for 10 minutes and identifying every bird possible. in a given morning, you know, I may record 200 to 300 individual birds that I've actually identified individually. And of those 200 to 300, I probably have seen one or two. We also do undertake macaw monitoring, where we sort of count the amount of macaws and parrots and other large birds that cross large open spaces such as rivers. When it comes to the thing that I like the most about working with birds, it's got to be a combination of just being able to be around birds that close. You know, they just are so incredible when they're in your hand and up close. You know, that a lot of the birds we work with are browner colored or gray and black. The average person who doesn't appreciate birds as much, maybe, they might look a little bit boring, but when they're in your hand, they're just all these little shadings, these colors, the intricacies of their feathers and their body really come alive. When it comes to volunteers coming in who may want to, you know, prepare, the first thing is obviously to try to understand, you know, what species are here. Trying to memorize 600 species before you arrive in the country is pretty hard. However, what people can do is they can start to understand the families. Again, I always say this with all the groups I work with. So, you know, Femnophilidae, Fernariidae, Formicariidae, Pipridae, Tyrannidae, you know, these are some of the families we get. And understanding those families, what they do, how they look, etc., really helps. But if you're looking for a well-rounded experience relating to tropical ornithology, I really think we offer a really good program for that. And I think one of the good things about our program and really all the teams we have at Fauna Forever is that we really develop relationships with our volunteers. And if you're the kind of person that's interested and curious and wants to engage and talk and learn, then that's what we thrive on. And we really have that connection, you know, and people are given the chance, depending on their skill level, to interact and help handling and extracting those birds. But they're always given the chance to engage as well in questions and understanding everything relating to or research in general, and specifically ornithology. So I really think we offer that that really kind of personal opportunity to learn here in the Peruvian Amazon of Fauna Forever.